I'm Tom Morton. I'm the director of the ACIJ, and welcome to all of you here in the UTS Media Studio and all of you watching our webcast at the moment on investigate.org.au. And particular welcome to our panel, Nick McKenzie from Fairfax Media, Steve Pennells from the West Australian, Mark Polden, media lawyer and former counsel for Fairfax, and David Bennett, ACQC, former Commonwealth Solicitor General. We've put together this very eminent panel to talk about an issue that's on the mind of every journalist in Australia at the moment, or an issue that should be on their minds anyway. How safe are our sources? Confidential sources are absolutely critical to robust investigative journalism and to the disclosure of information in the public interest. And that's information that often, usually in fact, someone wants to keep hidden. But right now across Australia, a number of journalists are facing intense pressure in the courts to disclose their confidential sources. And two of those journalists are here with us tonight. They publish stories that respectively involve the most powerful and important financial institution in Australia, the Reserve Bank, and one of the most powerful individuals in Australia, Gina Rinehart, Australia's richest woman and the biggest shareholder in Fairfax. So we'll hear from Nick and Steve in a moment, but just a quick word to those of you who are watching our webcast. Our hashtag is ACIJSources, and we look forward to getting comments and questions from you on Twitter. We'll be able to take questions later on, both from the floor and from those of you watching the webcast via Twitter. So, to our panellists. And first of all, Nick McKenzie. Nick McKenzie has won 3 Walkley Awards and a swag of other awards for journalism. Nick and his colleague Richard Baker won the Walkley Award for Investigative Reporting in 2011 for their expose of alleged bribery and corruption by executives of Securency and Note Printing Australia. And many of you will know that those two firms were subsidiaries of the Reserve Bank. They also won the George Munster Prize for Independent Journalism for that story, and we like to mention that because that prize is awarded by the ACIJ. So, Nick, many people will have followed your investigation into Securency, Note Printing Australia and the Reserve Bank. It's been going on for some time now. But can you just recap at the beginning, what's at the heart of that story? What's it about?
Well, perhaps I should start by saying we broke the story thanks to a confidential source. So somebody who worked within the environment for one of these two subsidiaries owned by the Reserve Bank had gone to the police. The police weren't interested. His allegations were these two companies were allegedly paying bribes overseas in order to win contracts to print, say, the banknotes of Vietnam, change them from paper to plastic. They own the special Reserve Bank of Australia technology. So this whistleblower came to us, said the police aren't interested. Are you guys interested? We started to look at his material, and soon after a bit of digging, we realised there was some real substance to this. To cut a long story short, we broke a story alleging that both companies may be involved in bribery and that the Reserve Bank may have known about this activity. The police reopened their investigation, and after some months they charged up to a dozen executives or former executives of both companies, as well as both companies themselves. So that case at the moment is still going through the courts. And I guess a further and an important addition is the fact that the Reserve Bank of Australia itself has been called before multiple parliamentary committees to answer some pretty tough and still open questions about corporate governance failures. Basically, senior RBA officials failed to do their job to ensure that these companies did not engage in alleged bribery overseas.
There's a really important point there that I think needs picking up on, and that's that your source had, in a sense, tried to do what you might think was the right thing. He or she had gone first to the police.
Absolutely, and if that source, while working for the company, had been caught leaking to us, even after they'd gone to the police, had been refused, had the door shut in their face, if they were caught, they would have lost their job and possibly been charged with a criminal offence. And that's a very serious threat facing a lot of confidential sources at the moment.
And in fact, that source, or the program that you made for Four Corners, that then relied heavily on that confidential source, who of course wasn't named, wasn't seen on camera. There was a reconstructed interview with that source, but that really helped to bring the story into the national, or onto the national arena, into the public view. But even then, it's taken a long time for that to move through to a police investigation and scrutiny of the Reserve Bank and Senate committees.
Absolutely, and the central point to be made there is that often governments say, well, people shouldn't be leaking, and they shouldn't need to be confidential sources of journalists. They can go to the police, they can go to their boss and report misconduct or corruption. The fact of the matter is that more often than not, or quite often, that corruption's covered up, and therefore they've got no choice but to go to the media. Yet in Australia at the moment, doing that, they imperil their job and possibly their liberty. They could face criminal charges.
So the story that you and Richard Baker are under pressure for at the moment, the story that you're facing legal action for, was a story that was published late last year. That was a story that came after the initial story about these two subsidiaries of the Reserve Bank had been broken. What's that story?
The story was a development on the original stories, and basically we reported to the public that an Indonesian alleged bagman, so a middleman in Indonesia who allegedly handed over money from the Reserve Bank of Australia companies to very senior Indonesian officials, paid them bribes in return for these contracts, that he'd agreed to cooperate with the Australian government. He'd be flown to Australia and testify as a star witness in the prosecution against these former Reserve Bank of Australia banknote executives. So that was an important development. And as a result of that, it's quite a complicated little legal scenario, but in a nutshell, the defendants, those accused and their lawyers, argued that we could have only got the information from a government source and that they wanted to expose that leak, and in doing so they could expose the fact that the government was trying to undermine the process of justice in the court case. So the pressure was on us. We were subpoenaed to go to court and to reveal who our sources were. Our editors made that very clear that we won't do that. And in the meantime, our lawyers have been appealing that to higher courts.
Nick, one thing that's been a very important element in laws relating to the disclosure of confidential sources in the past and still is the notion of a public interest defence, that that's something that justifies the use of confidential sources and also justifies maintaining their confidentiality, maintaining that agreement of confidentiality between the journalist and the source. What was the public interest in disclosing that information about this alleged bagman?
Well, it was a very important development in this corruption case, keeping in mind that the Reserve Bank of Australia and the federal government up until now say or have tried to manifestly play down this scandal. And one of the missing elements of the scandal until we reported that story was there was no prima facie witness making allegations that they actually paid the bribes. So there was a lot of suspicious looking activity. There was huge amounts of money being sent to bank accounts in the Seychelles, Jersey Island. It all looked pretty allegedly bad. Yet here was someone we could tell the public and keep the pressure on the RBA and the government to say, this person stepping forward and saying, allegedly, I handed over the cash, I handed over the bribe. Now there's plenty of water under the bridge yet to go, they're just allegations, the person hasn't testified yet, but that clearly was an important development in what's still a very important story.
So in fact the lawyers for these executives, the ones who've been charged, they're basically trying to have the proceedings thrown out of court.
They're trying to use the argument that there's been an official leak, a government leak, and if they can prove that, it's their intention to argue to the court that there's been a fundamental betrayal of the justice process by the government, and therefore the case should be struck out. There's a lot of legal water to pass under the bridge until that happens, and we're appealing a key aspect of that at the moment.
So what are your lawyers arguing? What outcome do you and your lawyers want from this legal action at the moment?
Well, it's bound up in legal technicalities at the moment, which I probably shouldn't go into. But the fundamental principle behind it, our editor has made this clear, that in no circumstance does a journalist from Fairfax Media give up a source, not if they're called to a Star Chamber hearing before an anti-corruption commission, not if they're called before a court, issued a subpoena. We simply can't do it. Now that may put us in breach of the law. We respect the law. We don't want to break the law. Journalists should not be above the law. Yet in these circumstances, when it comes to a confidential source, we simply can't reveal them. The reason being, if we start giving up sources, nobody will come to journalists and give us the information the public deserves to hear.
So what are you and Richard Baker facing if you potentially have to appear in court and have to be asked to reveal the name of your source? What could happen to you?
Well, we would, and journalists broadly, most journalists, or hopefully all journalists, would refuse to do that. And the worst penalty is being sent to prison. So, I mean, I think that would be unlikely, but that's certainly within the range of punishment. No journalist, no person wants to be on the wrong side of the court or a judge or in contempt of court. But if we refuse to give up our source's name, as we would, potentially be in contempt of court, which is a serious criminal offence.
All right, well, we'll keep that in the back of our minds. They could potentially be in contempt of court, potentially charged with serious criminal offences. Let's move on to Steve Pennells, because you're in the firing line too. Now, I have to say that Steve scooped the pool at last year's Walkleys. He won a gold Walkley for his reports on Australia's richest woman, Gina Rinehart, and her legal battles with her children over a family trust worth billions of dollars. He also got Scoop of the Year for that story, and he won his third Walkley, for social equity journalism for a story about a group of asylum seekers who drowned when their boat sank 200 kilometres north of Christmas Island. So a lot of Walkleys at last year's Walkley Awards, but it also seems to be that winning the gold Walkley is a pretty sure way of getting yourself into legal trouble. What was the story that won you the Walkley and that attracted the ire of Gina Rinehart?
Well, the gold was for, I think, both stories, for the Pakistan story and the Gina Rinehart one. But the Gina Rinehart one, I mean, we all know about her battles with the children now. And at the time, which was March last year, she was still fighting to have the whole case suppressed. No one knew any details about the battle. We found out the circumstances behind it, that she was shifting the family, the date of the vesting of the trust by half a century, the battle back and forth between the kids, and we ran a series of stories which were also run in The Age and the Sydney Morning Herald. And then I went across to Hong Kong and I spoke to her son over there, who was meeting with some people who were funding the case. The Monday after that, I got myself and the paper got some subpoenas seeking every bit of communication to dealing with Gina Rinehart, emails, text messages, phone records, notes of conversations, recordings, dating back to September 4, 2011. So currently that sits at a year and a half worth of records that they're seeking.
That's a big claim that they make.
It is a very big claim, yeah.
Just so that we're clear, and because we do also have viewers watching our webcast mm-hmm. who aren't in Australia, this is a quarrel, a battle, a family argument, yeah. A family feud that's been going on for a long time, and there's billions of dollars at stake. Just tell us a little bit more about what's going on.
Well, you know, go back. Obviously, I'm preempting your public interest question, which is what you asked me. And I mean, on the surface, it is a very salacious, juicy family battle. You know, the emails are great; everyone loves reading that kind of stuff. But we're talking about the richest person in Australia, who runs one of the biggest mining operations in the country. She lobbies against the mining tax. She lobbies for special economic zones in the north. She's got the ear of and the admiration of, according to the polls, the next prime minister of the country. She's very, very powerful and influential. And three of her children were taken to court alleging, in their words, not mine, gross misconduct and dishonesty over her management of the family trust, which in essence holds a quarter of her company. I think that's definitely in the public interest.
And so, as I understand it, what's at stake in the legal action that's being taken against you is an attempt by Gina Rinehart's lawyers to prove that her children have breached a confidentiality agreement that was part of the family trust.
The first subpoenas were, obviously, their argument is that I could have only got my information from a core group of people, and all of these people were party to certain confidentiality arrangements. The first subpoena dealt with all the children. It's been narrowed down to just one of the children. And there's a private action going on in the New South Wales Court of Arbitration, which I'm not party to, I'm not privy to because it's confidential. But it's trying to prove that someone in that circle has breached that confidentiality by giving me information. And to prove that, they're subpoenaing all my records to show that someone within that circle gave me information.
I am going to put the question anyway. Yeah. I mean, why is it in the public interest that your source be protected?
Well, I think it goes to the bigger picture of the commitments you give as a journalist. I mean, like Nick said, you know, no one will talk to you if your source is not protected. The sources behind this story didn't just happen overnight. They're sources that I've built up over many, many years who trusted me and got to the point where they felt confident that if they gave me information, I would protect them. And the moment you don't, it doesn't just... I mean, I may as well give up my job if I give them up, because there's no one will ever talk to me again as well. And other journalists won't, you know, other journalists won't find people want to talk to them either. It's just so important that, you know, people like Nick and myself, and there are, I think, three others currently in Australia facing, you know, potential jail time for not for, you know, for similar things. You know, you've got to prove to the public that there is some integrity in an industry that is, you know, does get bashed around a lot. You know, I mean, it is, you know, we're not the most respected industry around, and you know, this is critical. This is the principle is critical to what we do.
To our
professional ethics. Yeah, and getting the stories that need to be told, like the conspiracy story and things like that. Yeah.
So, for you, this has been going on for a year now.
Yeah, over a year. Yeah, I think it was last week or the week before was 12 months exactly.
And where are you up to in there?
We're still fighting it. I have to fly back to Perth in May for another court appearance. So we're still battling it. It looks like it'll go on for quite a bit longer. Mm-hmm. So it is quite, you know, it's sort of been hanging over me for about a year.
And your editor's been completely behind you?
They've been brilliant. They've been fantastic. I mean, my editor and my editor-in-chief have been at court every day with me. They said from the start, we will not reveal our sources. Pennells will not reveal his sources. And they've backed me 100%, which has been brilliant.
Okay, so look, I think we've got a good idea of what's at stake in these cases, and we'll certainly come back to them and explore them in a bit more detail later on. But I want to go on now to Mark Polden. Mark Polden was in-house counsel for Fairfax Media for the best part of two decades, and in 2006 he was a member of the Australian Law Reform Commission Advisory Committee on Sedition, a good subject. He's also the co-author with Mark Pearson of The Journalist's Guide to Media Law, which is now in its fourth edition. And he's now a barrister in private practice. In fact, he's come straight from the courtroom today from a hot case. He told me he only got the brief yesterday afternoon, so it's terrific that he's with us here now. Now, Mark, we've been told that shield laws will solve the kinds of problems that Nick and Steve have been talking about. Mm. What are shield laws?
Well, before I perhaps address what shield laws are, I think I should say that I don't think the ones we've got at the moment are any kind of panacea. What they do at their best, I think with the best of intentions, they set out to strike an improved balance in which it is recognised that there is a public interest in the dissemination of news and opinion, and that there is a public interest in encouraging the free flow of information and access to that. And one of the ways you do that is by assuring people that if they are given an undertaking of confidentiality, it will be respected. The difficulty is in, or the devil is in, the detail. And I would have to say that I think certainly the laws in West Australia fall a very, very long way short of what might be hoped for, and even the laws in Victoria, you know, borderline in terms of how much they would improve or have improved Nick's position if he was able to take advantage of them. He's not able to take advantage of them because their operation is not retrospective.
Yeah, so in other words, your story was published before the shield laws came into operation.
That's right, and had it been published afterwards, you still rely on the discretion of the court to say, okay, the only circumstance in which that journalist can keep his mouth shut is if the interest of justice, or the interest of him keeping his mouth shut, override the interest of justice. And one could argue in this case, the court would not come to that opinion. In fact, courts across the whole often, like the community at large, look at journalists in a pretty dim light. There's not many judges that I've come across who love journos. So if we're going to be relying on judicial discretion, we're in trouble.
I think, look, some of that is certainly in line with my experience. Some of it isn't. I think judges don't like sending people to jail. That's the first thing. And generally, you have, I think, some kind of margin of appreciation. So judges will generally try to find a way around this particular problem. When you get to this pointy end, what the shield laws are trying to do is to set up a presumption that you will not be required to disclose a source unless the people who are insisting on a disclosure can show that the interest in that disclosure happening in the particular circumstances. And I know this is an anathema to all journalists, but this is the way the law, the shield laws work. Unless the person seeking disclosure can show that the interest in disclosure in that particular case outweighs any damage that could be done, including to the person who's the confidential source and to the journalist, because no one will speak to them again, and it outweighs the interest in public getting information, news, opinion, and it outweighs the, if you like, the consideration which says, well, there'll be a chilling effect if we let these confidential undertakings be knocked down. Unless it outweighs all of that, you ought to be protected. But the devil is in the detail. And I could give you a couple of examples of that which are of enormous concern. And the first one is what the laws actually cover and what they don't. They won't protect you, for example, they won't protect any journalist who receives a production order from a body like the Police Integrity Commission. That's not a court. They won't protect you, except in Victoria, if you get a search warrant. They won't protect you in West Australia if you are seeking protection not against an order compelling you to give order evidence in court, but against an order that requires you to do something preparatory, like produce documents. So the devil's in the detail. They won't protect you if it is a matter which falls within the purview of that part of the Commonwealth Crimes Act, which was amended in 2005 under anti-terrorism legislation, the Anti-Terrorism Act 2005 number 2. And strangely enough, despite its name, that has got very broad application to a whole range of criminal offences, including the one which people often find themselves up against, which is Section 70 of the Commonwealth Crimes Act, which criminalises dissemination of information by a public servant or a former public servant that they got while they were a public servant. And the effect of that legislation is that the shield laws basically get trumped. They won't operate if you're dealing in that, you're swimming in that kind of pool. So, look, they're a good start, and, you know, it's something to, I suppose, aim towards bettering, but I really think, particularly in Steve's case, they're unlikely to be of much utility at all.
Well, you know? Another thing, too, is the WA laws, which are still to be tested, but to try and get protection of the laws, you have to prove a arrangement or confidentiality agreement with the source.
That's right.
And by doing that, you have to produce to the court that agreement, whether it be in writing or notes or something, and then you're actually revealing your source in the production of that document. So it's kind of...
It's a difficult...
The
other thing in the West Australian Act, which is quite bizarre, I mean, just to set out very basically the scheme of all of the acts, what they say is, essentially, if you're a journalist and that's defied either more broadly or less broadly, depending on what jurisdiction you're in, the coverage is very patchy. It's defined quite narrowly in Victoria. In the Commonwealth Act, it's quite broad, takes in bloggers and so on. But let's assume you get over the first hurdle and you say, yes, I'm a journalist, and this material was given to me in the course of my work as a journalist, and I gave a promise to a source. Then the legislation creates the presumption in your favour and says, well, unless the interest, the public interest in the particular case outweighs these other factors we've talked about, protected. In the West, it's very strange, because there's then a further turnaround which says, unless you were guilty as a journalist, and the focus becomes on the conduct of the journalist of quote-unquote misconduct. What's misconduct? Well, in Steve's case, one species of misconduct which the Act says will generally result in an order being made for compulsory disclosure is where you unreasonably intrude on someone's privacy. And then it goes on to define privacy as the interest private individuals have in keeping their private affairs private, commercial in confidence, cabinet confidentiality, the list goes on. And the most bizarre twist in it is one of the other factors that can be taken into account is whether the matter was, the journalist was guilty of quote-unquote partiality. They were partial in their reporting. That can be a factor that can amount to misconduct, which can knock the privilege which you might otherwise have flat on its face. So in West Australia, at least, the laws probably really aren't worth the paper they're written on.
got to say.
Company.
Sorry, Steve, but you know, well, look, I've got to say it.
I'd like to go to David Bennett now. Yeah. David Bennett was the Solicitor General of the Commonwealth of Australia for 10 years, from 1998 to 2008. He served as President of the New South Wales Bar Association and the Australian Bar Association from November 1995 to February 1997. And he was appointed a companion of the Order of Companion in the Order of Australia in the Queen's Birthday Honours List 2008 for services to the law. So, David Bennett, we've had some strong statements made here, but perhaps I'll take you back to one that Nick made. He said, if we have to trust in the discretion of judges, we're in a lot of trouble. Do you agree?
To a large extent, yes. I very much agree with the statement that was just made, that the devil is in the detail. It's clear that there should be some sort of shield laws protecting journalists, protecting them from having to disclose names. The problem is that there are a large number of exceptional circumstances where they should have to disclose names. And the problem is, how do you define those circumstances? There are basically two ways you can do it. One is to do what the current shield laws do, which is to say, oh, it's a matter for the discretion of the court. You weigh the public interest in publishing the information. You weigh the public interest in protecting the source and protecting journalists generally from disclosing sources, and you balance it all up. The problem with that is, what does the journalist say when the source rings up in the first place and says, can you assure me you're going to be able to keep this secret? And the journalist says, oh, it's perfectly safe because a judge will weigh it up and come to the conclusion that I don't have to disclose your name. So that's the problem with a law that leaves it discretionary. On the other hand, of course, if you have a law which defines all the relevant circumstances, it's going to read something like the Income Tax Assessment Act in its length and complexity. That may not be a bad thing necessarily, but and let me give you examples of the sort of circumstances which would concern me. We all know about the obvious examples, the privacy examples, where something is printed about a prominent person's sexual activities or peccadilloes, to what extent that informant is entitled to confidentiality and what the public interest is both ways. But let me give you some more difficult ones. Suppose you get information that a large public company is on the verge of insolvency, and you publish that, and the question arises about your source. Now, of course, to me, the question whether you should have to disclose the source may depend a great deal on what the source is. On the one hand, the source might be a genuine whistleblowing employee who feels that this ought to be disclosed and so on. And we all know that whistleblowers are lovely people. And and we would all agree that that whistleblower should be protected. But now assume that the source is a disgruntled employee who's been sacked and trying to get revenge on the company. That's a little more difficult, isn't it? Now let's assume that the informant is a person who doesn't really have the information, is lying about that, but is an investor who has shorted the company on the stock exchange and wants to bring it down. Now, we're really not very concerned at all about protecting that person, are we? So the and it also might be a trade rival, it might be a speculative liquidator who's looking for work. There are all sorts of situations, and there are borderline situations. You might get a fairly aggressive and perhaps sometimes irrational dissident director who is at odds with the company and telling you the company's insolvent less because it's true than because he wants to get at the rest of the board, or she does. So there can be very difficult situations. And one big question, which is not addressed in the legislation, is the truth of it relevant? Do you owe a greater duty of confidentiality to someone who's told you the truth than to someone who's told you a load of cobblers? It seems to me there's a real argument which says that an undertaking of confidentiality may well be, at least to some extent, impliedly conditional on the truth of the information. But again, that's a difficult question. There are cases where that is relevant and cases where it's not.
Can I just ask the journalists on the panel, just perhaps to comment on those examples that that David Bennett's raised, because there's some questions there, I suppose, about journalistic method. You know, you've cited the example of somebody, you know, a source who gives you information on a company that's about to go insolvent. I mean, what would you be doing as a journalist?
There's a good real-life case, which is the case of Godwin Gretsch, the public servant who committed, allegedly, a fraud upon a journalist. He said, this is an email which exposes corruption involving politicians, and he'd concocted that, or allegedly concocted that. So did the journalist in that situation have an obligation to protect the identity of that source? That's an open question. But if a source lies to us, and that happens all the time, we're the gatekeepers of the information we publish. So our job is to not just take the source at face value, but test his information. Now, sources have all sorts of motivations. And I think if we start to say, well, if you lie, we're not going to protect you, we're in a world of trouble. People leak for all sorts of reasons. Their motivation may be impure, but the information they leaked might be very much in the public interest. We still have to protect that person. And so, you know, I'd say very rarely would we ever say, I'm going to release or walk away from a confidentiality agreement.
I think I always approach it on the fact that if someone's talking to me, there's a reason they're talking to me, especially a source, especially if they want to be protected. There's a, you know, then no one's just going to call up and you know, just purely out of, you know, the goodness of their heart. They either want to see an outcome, they want to see the story in the paper for some reason. So you've got to be aware of that, and the onus is on us to actually make sure that what they're telling us is accurate and looking into that. And the other thing too is there's a difference between someone who might contact you and offer information, you know, out of the blue, or someone you may be going after, in a sense, trying to get information. So someone you know is in a certain position, who knows certain information, and then you speak to them, and that's on the condition that they're confidential. So you have an understanding already that what the position they're in, the access to information they've got, and you have an awareness of the story. So that's I think they're quite different things.
Mm. Could I comment on this? I know it's generally an anathema to give up a source, and I've got to say that nobody has ever done it on my watch at Fairfax, and no one's ever gone to jail either. But having said that, I do wonder about the complete inflexibility of the Code of Ethics, where it says respect, where confidences are accepted, respect them in all circumstances. And I do think that it's difficult. I think the argument is, well, you need a hard, bright, clear line, and people need to understand it, and you know once you start fiddling with that and saying there's circumstances where we won't protect a source, you know, people are going to have a degree of disquiet about coming forward, and I think that's completely understandable, but on the other hand, I do think it puts journalists in a very invidious position where, and I've seen it done. I mean, I've seen people burnt. And I've seen, I mean, you know, the examples that David gives, I mean, the kinds that I've seen are materials purporting to support very serious and unsavoury allegations about a very senior judicial officer being leaked against that person, materials obtained by the Police Royal Commission via phone taps being leaked, obviously as a warning to people that you know, stay away from this topic because we can get this stuff out there. As David says, there are some questions which are really very, very serious, and I think when you've got a code of ethics that says thou shalt not in absolutely unadulterated terms, it does put you in an extraordinarily difficult extraordinarily difficult position. I accept that experienced journalists will be in a position, particularly where you've been working and cultivating somebody for a period of time, to make that judgment. But there are things at the margin which are incredibly difficult.
I think the problem is a journalist, you know, they want to believe the information. If you get something juicy, the natural instinct is you want it to be true.
Sure.
And some people cut corners to publish that, and that's a risk that, you know, that we shouldn't take, but a lot of people do that because they just want to believe it. And I've seen cases with colleagues of mine who have rushed to publish information without checking things, and it's been, you know, inaccurate, or it's been, you know, it's been fed to them for a reason.
Two other situations you may want to think about are the one where a person is on trial for murder and someone rings you and says, don't tell anyone, but I'm the one who did it. That's one problem. Another problem is the blackmailer who, not having been paid, decides to do his or her worst and reveal the dirty little secret to you. I mean, I suppose a lot of these situations are simply situations where you shouldn't publish, rather than situations where you shouldn't have to disclose, or you should have to disclose. But it's the real point is there are so many possible situations, you really need to work out a very elaborate and complicated code that deals with all the major situations.
Yes, well, in fact, I've given a copy of the current Commonwealth Shield laws to David Bennett because he asked for them, and I was quite surprised to discover that they're just 2 pages long. So the code that he's talking about is one that potentially could be hundreds of pages long. The one we've got is just 2 pages long, and certainly brevity is the soul of wit, but perhaps we don't feel very safe with something that's just 2 pages long. I'll come back to that in a moment, but just like to remind those of you watching our webcast at investigate.org.au that we'd welcome questions from you. The hashtag is ACIJSources, and we'd also take some questions from the floor in a moment. And could I ask those of you who have questions, and I can see someone up there who has already, just to wait until the microphone comes to you. Because we are going live on the webcast, they need to be able to hear you as well. So if you could put your hands up now, if you want to ask questions, we'll get the microphones to come to you. But I just want to ask the journalists again, I mean, the sanctity of the code of ethics, how important is it?
It depends what news organisation you're talking about. you're talking about examples when people called you up. I mean, I know I wouldn't chase some of those stories, but I know other organisations would. So I guess it depends, you know. I mean, it's a flexible thing, and people, you know, pick and choose and cherry pick what they want to suit their purposes. I mean, it's sad, but it's true.
And whenever you legislate for anything complicated, you have to make the decision as to how complicated you make the law. I mean, the most simple examples, the law that says you can't park at a bus stop, that's obviously a very sensible law. It would make things very inconvenient if buses couldn't pull into bus stops. But what about during a bus strike? Why shouldn't you be allowed to park at a bus stop during a bus strike? Now, in fact, we don't have an exception in that situation, nor do we have an exception if the bus stop's outside a hospital and you're stopping to take in a critically ill patient to casualty. There are all sorts of situations where once you have a specific law that lays down a rule, you're going to have unjust applications of that rule. Now, the ideal is that every one of those situations is covered in the legislation. But that means the legislation is 10 times as long and much more complicated, and lawyers are required to look at it a bit more than in other cases. That may be a good thing, I suppose. But and that's very much the problem here. What we've got is a nice, simple code that says, oh, it's all a matter of discretion. You weigh up the factors. But it's not as easy as that. Some of the factors simply are not listed. There are some situations where clearly there should be protection, and some clearly where there shouldn't. I suppose the example I gave of the man on trial for murder, where someone rings you up and says, I'm the one who did it, there's a real question then, it seems to me, which probably has to be answered against journalists' privilege. You can't let the innocent man go to jail for life because of the principle of journalistic privilege. But on the other hand, there are innumerable situations where the privilege is terribly important, and we wouldn't get exposure of all sorts of things if we didn't have some sort of shield laws. And as I say, the problem is, do you have a general provision, or do you try and deal with as many situations as you can?
We'll take a question in a moment, but I know that Nick is dying to say something. Yeah,
just in, this is all very interesting in theory, but in working reality, the fact of the matter is the authorities who can have that discretion in reality exercise it, I think, often very poorly. And a really clear example, and one I've dealt with and many other journalists have, is police corruption. The police force command's institutional response is to put it, if they're going to talk about it, to make it a one-line statement that means nothing in a media release. You need police to break the law or internal regulations and leak to you. Every time that happens, and you do a big story about police corruption, there's almost every time there's a witch hunt about, regardless of the public interest of the story, about who leaked to the reporter. That happens terribly often, and I think what's happening more and more is you've got the Police Integrity Commission or the Office of Police Integrity, these anti-corruption bodies using their tremendous power, phone tapping, call charge records, coercive questioning, to find out who that source is, again with no thought about the public interest of the actual story. That's happening time and time again, and that's the real problem I think journalists are facing in Australia at the moment.
Question from the floor.
I just wanted to ask about the burden that you place on intent. If you're a source comes to you with information and through your vetting that you find out that they have perhaps a questionable intent, but also that the information is also accurate and in the public interest, how would your decision-making factor that in?
Well, my job's to serve, I mean, it's simple, I think. My job's to serve the public and not my source's motivations. And as long as I keep that at the forefront of my mind, then their motivations, while I've got to be wary of them, testing information, as long as I'm thinking, well, what does the public deserve to know, then it's a pretty simple equation.
It's like any story, you know, a source is just part of a story, and every time you compile a story, you don't just do it off one bit of information. You look around, and in a story from a source, you've got to do the same thing. The source is just part of it. It feeds in a certain aspect, and it's up to you to research it, put it in a context, and work out what's legit, what's not, and everything else.
Well, let me put the practical example of the blackmailer with a few details in it. Someone is blackmailing someone and saying, I will reveal your guilty secret unless you pay me money. The person refuses and in fact goes to the police. The blackmailer, not having been paid, goes to you and reveals the dirty little secret. In order to prove the prosecution case against the blackmailer, which is word against word, of course, it's just conversations, the prosecution wants to prove that the blackmailer went to the press and disclosed the information. Now, that's a case where it seems to me the public interest in disclosing the name to assist in the prosecution may well outweigh the general principle that that information given to a journalist is sacrosanct. I mean, one could argue that a person in that situation shouldn't have the right to feel that the information is sacrosanct, that it can be disclosed or disclosed with impunity. So there are examples of cases like that. The problem is to define them and limit them.
Question then?
My question is to Nick and Steve. Given that there are some quite serious deficiencies in source protection in Australia, I'm wondering if you can both tell us a bit more about what measures you use to mitigate the risks to your sources. Do you encrypt your electronic discussions? Do you even mitigate those electronic conversations?
Absolutely, yeah. So I'm always mindful of the records that my phone records will show. There's a whole lot of applications online that you can use to communicate with people. But the really simple way to deal with confidential sources is face to face. And if I have to discuss something important, I'll sit down and have a cup of coffee, maybe mix up your location. And it's ridiculous, I think, in the modern society that a journalist, in the New York Times journal, made this point. We've got to act like almost like criminals, like drug traffickers covering our tracks to do what is a job that's in the public interest. And I think the balance has swayed too far. And how to bring it back? I mean, we need governments and government departments and police forces to actually acknowledge the importance of whistleblowers and journalism and to stop doing these using their powers to go after journalist sources. It's at the front of my mind whenever I contact somebody in the Defence Department or a police force, this could come back to bite them. So I've got to protect them in the way I contact them.
Yeah, same as Nick, a lot of it's face-to-face. And that's something instigated by the sources. They don't want to put anything in writing. They don't want any records. They don't want anything to come back on them. And that's a difficulty. And it's not, I mean, there are circumstances where it's not necessarily just the authorities you have to worry about, but there are circumstances where, and I've had this, where you have private detectives put on you to track information by someone you're doing a story on to find out where you got information from. And often they won't necessarily work within the bounds of the law either. So you've got to be mindful that they could get information quite easily.
The other way of going about it, and I'm not saying I recommend it, but the WikiLeaks version of the Dropbox, which comes with its own problems, because it's then difficult, if not impossible, to test the veracity of your source. So I think it's interesting, there's either the very almost pre-industrial, face-to-face, you could sit down there with a pen and paper, or you then go to the other extreme, which is complete encrypted anonymity, and you just try to judge. Yeah, you try to judge the material against other bits of material that you've got in order to come to a conclusion about its veracity. But it's an extraordinarily difficult thing. The phone problem is one that started to arise. With the fact of everybody having mobile phones I don't know what it's going to mean for bloggers as well. I don't know whether the loss of our anonymity means. I mean, you would think in a way that should be a good thing for source protection, but maybe it's not. We seem to be tracked everywhere we go. So I think face to face is the best way.
We've got a question on Twitter about a particular case. Which Nick McKenzie and Richard Baker are also facing legal action for. Now, Nick has said to me that this is a very sensitive case and we have to be a bit careful of what we say. But it's about the Helen Liu story. Nick, perhaps you could have a crack. This might be sort of reasonably uncontroversial. Could you just tell us what was at stake in that original story?
Well, the original story involved the Age of the Sydney Morning Herald reporting that about a relationship between the then Defence Minister, Joel Fitzgibbon, and a Chinese businesswoman called Helen Liu, and people within the defence establishment had concerns about that relationship, and subsequently the minister disclosed to the public that he'd taken certain gifts he hadn't put on his register of gifts, and he had to stand down as a minister, but there was legal action initiated by Helen Liu and Joel Fitzgibbon as a result of our stories. It's a complicated action, but I think, put simply, these parties, especially Liu and Fairfax Media, have expended a huge amount of resource to date, battling in the courts. And we've been trying to preserve our source or sources, and her lawyers have been trying to get at the sources and to reveal their identity. It's been going for a couple of years now, and it does have a fairly chilling effect on us as reporters, because we think to ourselves, gosh, I don't want to get into this legal quagmire again. And you end up walking away from, thinking about walking away from what potentially are really important public interest stories. So that case has been subject of appeals, and we're still battling it out.
Actually, you've raised a really important point there, and I might ask Steve to comment on that too. I mean, the action that's been taken by Gina Reinhardt against you, and we know, of course, now that further action is being taken against Adele Ferguson, another Fairfax journalist. What kind of effect is that having on journalists and the reporting of that story?
Well, aside from the fact you have to second-guess yourself, and I know some journalists have been scared of the Reinhardt story, the more concerning aspect is a lot of sources, a lot of people have stopped talking or will not talk because they say, well, you know, we know your protector, your sources, but how can we be sure of that? How can we know that they won't get hold of this information? And, you know, I mean, ostensibly the case is about trying to find out who my sources are. But, you know, I would suspect that possibly, which I can't, you know, go to the motivation of it, but a greater impact is it's shutting up people who may be talking out of school and warning journalists, scaring off journalists who may be thinking of doing those stories. So, in a sense, the action has already possibly had a desired effect because it has shut a lot of doors to a lot of journalists on the sources side and the journalist side.
That's the smart way. I'm not saying it's happening in this particular case. I'm not expressing a view about it, but I've certainly seen it done, and there are people who specialise in shutting up newspapers rather than by suing them for defamation. They will always target the source, and they'll do it in an iterative way. They'll go for discovery before action and try to target that person rather than the journalist. There was a case involving Gerard Ryle, who's now working in the States, as you'd know, and the West Australian Rugby Union, where precisely that was what happened. And there was a search order obtained in relation to the putative source. And this is a good question. I mean, this is one that, to me, throws things up in pretty stark relief. There was a search order granted against the notional source, the person who was presumed to be the source. That person produced, didn't challenge the order and for some reason, and produced a whole lot of material, some of which were email communications with the journalist, Gerard Ryle, and some of which were email communications to a third-party email address. Using that material, the plaintiff then sought to get the other end of the communication from Gerard Ryle. The source hadn't released Gerard Ryle, so you're still in a situation where, in effect, your own source has given you up. I've seen that happen twice now. I've seen it happen in another case involving a whistleblowing doctor and a confidential information case where essentially the doctor settled with the other people, left Fairfax out to dry, and didn't release Fairfax from the obligation of confidentiality. What do you do then? It's a solemn farce. Everybody knows who it is. The other parties know who it is. But if you take a strict view of it, you're still bound. So, you know, they say hard cases make bad law. You know, really it's I suppose at the margins, though, you know, I would come back to it, those kinds of circumstances where the ethical rule says thou shalt not. But I mean, perhaps David Bennett was also saying, well, how do you formulate exceptions? Well, there are exceptions to legal professional privilege. I know, again, it's anathema to even think of an exception. But for example, fraud, where it's been used in the furtherance of a fraud. You know, there may be, it probably is not hard to identify at least some very core categories that people might be able to agree about, where I would have thought where you've really been used up by somebody and they've positively used you as an agent to carry out some kind of a fraud. You know, some consideration should be given, I think, to the rules allowing a degree of flexibility there. A lot of people wouldn't agree with me about that, but, you know, I think at the moment people are placed in a very, very difficult position, and I think that, you know, one looks at the end for the shield laws, but I do think one should look at the ethical obligations as well and ask, do they need to be absolutely absolute? I can understand the reasons why it might be said they do, but I think there are reasons to look at them as well.
Absolutely absolute. That's a good
absolutely phrase. Absolute. Yeah.
Got a question for you.
That's really what my question was about. I wanted to ask Nick and Steve what their response is to this concern about the absolute nature of keeping a source confidential, whether you do think there are any circumstances where you ought to consider that as a journalist.
Well, if the source, in some circumstances, and they're pretty rare, but if the source releases themselves, and there's an example that happened to me, I won't go into too much detail, but the source was a organised crime figure. They relayed information to me that related to perhaps who committed a gangland double murder. And I was asked about how I got the information, and I said, I can't tell you who the source is, but I'll go back to the source and I'll ask them. And the source said to me, I don't mind. you can tell that investigator to come and speak to me. So he gave me his total approval, his total informed consent. But there's another example where the Australian newspaper wrote about a terrorism raid. The paper hit the streets. Police said it hit the streets before the raid occurred. And in this situation, the source, or alleged source, was a Victorian policeman who'd spoken to a reporter from the Australian. And the investigating agency, the OPR, looking into who leaked, they got a waiver from this source and gave it, put it in front of the journalist, and it said, you're now released. So the journalist talked about his interaction with the source, and to this day regrets doing so, because that was used to charge the source, who was recently pleaded guilty. I think he was convicted as well. And it had a terrible outcome, and really the leak was not poorly motivated, although the outcome in terms of the newspaper publishing early was poor. But you had a situation there where sort of trickery was used in some respects to get a source to release a journalist. And that's where you need a blanket, in some respects, a blanket rule to say, do not reveal sources in any circumstances. Because even the source outs themselves and says, okay, they don't know what's coming down the track for them. And I think the blanket rule, I appreciate where the lawyers are coming from, but in my experience, those going after our sources don't care about what the public interest is, don't care about the work of journalists at all. And we need to say to these people, well, I'll refer you back to my ethics book, I'm not going to budge on this, I'm sorry.
Well, that's the advantage of that position. It's very, very clear and doesn't leave any room for doubt.
It's a big step to reveal a source in any circumstance, even if there's a situation where you have been totally shafted by the source. Mm. You're still the guy who gave up a source, and there's still people still see that and think, well, there might be a circumstance where he will give me up.
Yeah,
and you know, it's a tough one. I don't know if there'd be a situation where I'd do it.
David Bennett, can I ask you about a case that you were involved in? And this, in fact, was a case that really set the ball rolling in a way in terms of governments bringing in shield laws. And this was the story that was published by Gerard McManus and Michael Harvey of the Herald Sun in Melbourne. And it involved information that had been leaked by a public servant to them about a decision that the then Howard government was making about veterans' benefits. So the Howard government had conducted a review of veterans' benefits. One of the recommendations of that review was that veterans' benefits should be increased by a certain amount. And the government had decided to ignore the recommendations of the review and save itself $500 million. So the public servant in question thought that this was a matter of public interest, that the government wasn't going to raise veterans' benefits, and leaked that information to McManus and Harvey. They published the story, there was a police investigation by the Federal Police, and the public servant was charged. Can I ask you, in that instance, do you believe it was right that the public servant was charged for revealing that information?
Well, when you say right, there are many situations where people commit offences, but it is undesirable that they be charged with having done so. That's why we have directors of public prosecutions. And no doubt there are many factors both ways that would affect the mind of a DPP in that situation. I don't know that I think I'd need to know a lot more than you've just told me before I could.
Now, come on, I think you're being a bit disingenuous here, because you actually became involved in that case.
But not
can
in
you,
that aspect.
Can you tell us how?
Not in that aspect.
No.
The aspect I was involved in was different. In the course of the trial, the two journalists were asked to the witness box to name their source and refused to do so. The judge took the view that they should be charged with the appropriate offence of contempt, whatever it was, and the DPP picked up on it and they were charged. The Howard government took the view that that was undesirable and that they shouldn't be required to disclose their sources. But of course the DPP is independent and the government can't give directions to the DPP, except in very limited circumstances, which for reasons I won't bore you with, weren't relevant. So what happened was I was sent to court by the government to argue that what should occur is that the information should simply be dismissed without proceeding to conviction under, you know, the equivalent of Section 10, is on the basis that there was going to be legislation passed protecting journalist sources, and this was just before that legislation, and therefore it was undesirable to proceed. So one had at the hearing the DPP saying one thing and the Commonwealth, through the Solicitor General, saying another. The judge, I thought quite wrongly, got very upset at that and said, how can the Commonwealth speak with two opposite voices and so on? The answer is that one is the voice of an independent officer who is not bound by government instructions, and the other is the view of the government, and there's no reason why they shouldn't be different and in fact move in opposite directions. And
isn't it a bit... The judge got upset about it, and I mean, isn't it a little bit difficult to believe that the DPP would have undertaken the prosecution without some reference from...
No, absolutely the opposite. The DPP acts totally independently, and that case is a very good example. If the government has had its way, the prosecution wouldn't have been brought. There is a power in the Director of Public Prosecutions Act for the Attorney General to give a direction, but it's never used. And of course, the reason it's never used is that all governments want to be able to say, when they're criticised for prosecuting or not prosecuting someone, oh, there's nothing we can do about it. It's this independent person who makes the decision. It's like criticising us because a judge makes a decision. These are independent people who act independently. And once the government ever gives a direction to the DPP, it's always going to be open to people in the future to say to politicians, well, why didn't you give a direction in this case? So the government took the view, I think quite sensibly, that it wouldn't give a direction, and went to court to argue against the DPP. I think the judge was wrong to criticise that. It's, in a sense, a failure to appreciate the independence of the person who's making the other submission.
I mean, is the answer then to have better protection for whistleblowers? Do we need stronger laws to protect whistleblowers?
Oh, well, that's right. That case was before the Shield laws, and the whole point of our intervention was to say to the court, look, Shield laws are about to be put into effect, so you wouldn't prosecute. It's rather like saying in the days just before the decriminalisation of homosexual acts between consenting adults, if you had a case where there was an allegation of that sort of conduct immediately prior to the passing of the legislation, when it was known you were going to pass it, theoretically, you could prosecute the person, but any DPP or prosecuting sergeant or anyone else who did so would be quite mad, and you wouldn't do it. That was the argument we put, that in a case where there's about to be legislation changing the law, you shouldn't rush in just before it and prosecute someone. And, as I say, it wasn't... received with all that receptiveness, but in fact, I think in the end there were sort of light penalties imposed. There were just fines, which are obviously going to be paid by the newspaper. So,
we've got another question at the back there.
Given the presence of a potential conflict between ethics and Shield laws, and assume you know the legitimacy of your source 100%. What are some of the things that a journalist needs to do to ensure a foolproof investigative story that is foolproof in court?
Well, one of the things I was going to suggest, but I wasn't going to do it because it's going to take too long, is that it may be that there should be some sort of procedure in which you can go to court confidentially in advance and join the party who has an interest in confidentiality and the source with
all the names being suppressed and the proceedings heard in camera, and say to the court, please give me an advance ruling. If I publish this story, will I be entitled to protect the source?
So it's a kind of prenuptial agreement.
Yes, yes. Now, there are a lot of difficulties with that. It might be difficult to have the proceedings without the source being disclosed in those proceedings, and then there are questions, you know, it's any proceedings in camera are something the courts hate and journalists hate, and is to be avoided except where it's absolutely necessary. This may be a situation where it is necessary, so that one can get some sort of advance ruling, and you'd then be able to say to the source, well, unless I get the advance ruling that I won't have to disclose your name, I won't use the information.
Could that work?
No.
Be very different.
That sounds respectfully just unworkable. And as soon as we get authorities, courts involved in journalism, then the freedom of the press is at risk. And the simple way to keep... to protect a source, just keep your mouth shut in court, regardless of the cost. It's simple. And occasionally journalists have to bear the cost of that, and that's the hazard of our job.
If you've got a source who will only meet you at a car park and won't use it for a mobile phone, they're not going to go to court with you beforehand.
Well, I suppose if you are sent to jail, you'll get a great story out of it.
Aside to the journalists, what do you need to do as far as file notes are concerned? What do you, you know, do you need special file notes, special recordings, just to be sure that if you are caught up in court, you have all the information needed, all your...
What do you mean by special files or special recordings?
If you know, what kind of file notes do you have to keep, you know, if you were in court and you have to, you know...
You need to encrypt them or something? Is that the kind of question you're asking?
Exactly. Well, if you encrypt them, you're still in contempt because they'll need to be decrypted. The court will order you to give them decrypted. So I don't think there's a situation where you can protect yourself, because there are always going to be stories where someone can use the courts to try and you know, like you know, Nick's examples are perfect examples. I can't see any situation where they couldn't have avoided that. So you've got to make a conscious choice between protecting a source and running a story and possibly facing the penalties imposed by a court, and you've got to weigh that up every time with a story like this. It's possible.
And you've also got to be careful about the laws prohibiting the use of listening devices and all that sort of area of law. Although there's a nice loophole in that one. There's a loophole that you are not committing a breach of either state or federal law if you simply have a tape recorder at the end of a phone and record the phone conversation.
I'll tell my students.
There's authority on it. The reason is this, that the state law says you can't use any listening device or any machine to record a conversation without the consent of all the parties. The Commonwealth law says that you may not intercept a telephone conversation and record it, but it doesn't apply to interception between station and station. Sorry, within a station. So if you have two extension phones, what was said was that if someone listens on one without the party on the other knowing, you're not committing a breach of the Commonwealth Act because you're not intercepting between station and station, and you're not and the High Court said you're not committing a breach of the State Act because the Commonwealth Act covers the whole field of interception using telephones, and therefore the Listening Devices Act of the state can't apply to the use of a telephone to intercept a conversation. So, as I say, there are some loopholes there.
I was actually just reflecting when the anecdote about the translation, you know, being caused to produce, you know, you've got your file notes and produce something that, you know, I've seen that happen, and it happened. Actually, I think it was the case, not the one you were talking about earlier, but probably the genesis of the threats to journalists' freedom, which actually ended up indirectly in the Shield Laws, and it was actually the Chinese Embassy case back in 1995. If you recall, there were stories that came out. There was an injunction which was later dissolved, and the stories alleged that Australia had been bugging the Chinese Embassy. And the then Attorney General, Gareth Evans, after that all fell apart, proposed laws which would have seen journalists jailed. But there were orders made in that case that all of the original versions of the story, the original drafts, be produced to the New South Wales Supreme Court. And the old system at Fairfax, the overmatter, all the extra exclamation marks and letters and so on, used to get left at the end of the story. And it was just literally rubbish, but an order was made that this code, which obviously the spooks couldn't crack, had to be translated and provided to them, which I think probably demonstrates, coming back to why there's such paranoia and such a desire in some sectors of government to get on to leaks that really if they want to get onto it, they want to have a witch hunt, there's way around the existing Shield Laws. So I suppose the question is whether those particular and very onerous provisions in the Commonwealth Crimes Act and the matching provisions, say, in West Australia, which is Section 81 of the Criminal Code there, which is used to found, has been used to found search warrants against the West Australian in the past, whether those are really the things that need looking at.
I mean, we do have a question on Twitter from Hannah Sinclair. It's a good question, I think. If the Shield Laws are uncertain and don't or won't work, does that make them unnecessary?
I don't think so. I suppose it's a bit like... It's important, perhaps, to give an indication of where... they're aspirational, I suppose, in a sense, where the boundary might be, and maybe to give some judges a bit of wiggle room. I'd still maintain that most judges, and I know there's a contrary view in the room, but I think it's... I've seen on many occasions judges trying to bend over backwards to avoid putting a journalist in this situation between the devil and the deep blue sea. And if the laws don't work in their strict application, at least if they can, provide a bit of wiggle room, that's a good thing. If they can also at least provide us with a starting point and we can look at their failings, I suppose it's then a question of whether pressure can be brought to bear upon government to make them better. I'm not sure that governments of any stripe really want to... I could be wrong about this, I could be way too cynical, but I would have thought that that's not high on a government's agenda to want to improve those laws. Still, it's better than what we did have. You go back not all that long ago, all we had was the so-called newspaper rule, which was a rule of practice that said essentially in a defamation or a similar case, people won't be required to name their sources prior to trial, and that was it. So we've moved on a fair way from there.
What do the journalists think? I mean, if the Shield Laws don't work, are we better off with them or without them?
When the WA ones were introduced late last year, the politicians basically said, we know that this is imperfect, we know there are problems with this, but let's just get this in, and then it can be tweaked or amended later on. But the important thing was getting laws in place, and then moving from there. So, I mean, they acknowledged it when they brought them in that it was imperfect. And like I said, to protect a source, you have to reveal the source at a WA, which defeats the purpose, really. But they're there, and there's an awareness, and the judges, I know even in my case, the laws aren't retrospective when they came in after my case, but our arguments are still using those laws and the principle of the laws and the intent of the laws, even if we're not protected by it, to guide the judge in some way to say, this is kind of where we're coming from.
Well, I think that's similar to what David Bennett was saying earlier about the changes in laws dealing with homosexual relationships, that there was that has, even though it may not be of application in the particular case in terms of black letter law, it's certainly going to provide either some guidance in terms of prosecutors' prosecutorial discretion, or it's going to perhaps assist a judge in forming a view about it which may be a little bit more palatable for the journalists and the media than might otherwise have been the case.
Yeah. Nick, are you comforted by the fact that there are shield laws, even if they're not perfect? Or?
Yeah, I mean, flawed shield laws are better than no shield laws at all. And I think just that aspirational nature to have our government and its associated entities to send the message that what journalists do is legitimate and should be subject to at least some protection. And if that can go some way to changing attitudes, where a bureaucrat or a senior police officer will go, well, hang on a second, if I push this investigation to try to find a leak, it gets to court, the journalist might have a protection, he won't reveal his source. I mean, it's not going to amount to a great deal. Let's move on to the more serious issues. If it can change those attitudes, that's a really good thing.
Mm. And actually, a question I should have asked much earlier, but one that it's a stupid question, but sometimes it's good to ask stupid questions. If there are federal shield laws, why aren't all journalists covered by them?
I think federal shield laws only operate within certain Commonwealth jurisdictions. So, for instance, they don't apply to us in Victoria because I think we're bound up between the Victorian Magistrates Court in a state jurisdiction. So we're relying on the state laws there. But it's a good question and the principle is sound. I mean, if the federal government thinks it's good enough across the federal court sphere, why isn't it good enough across all courts? And I think that's why we desperately need there to be some unison across the states and the federal government to pass broad shield laws which operate everywhere.
You can actually end up in a very difficult situation where you can get in a state court where there is a Commonwealth offence has been charged and you get a split indictment which involves a Commonwealth charge and a state charge, and if there are, you've got two lots of shield laws working at the same time. Mm. So that can happen at the moment.
This is a good segue into the union was asking me to plug their medium freedom thing next Tuesday. Nick and I will be in Melbourne along with three other journalists who are all facing similar situations. There are currently five journalists in the country potentially facing jail for not revealing their sources, which I think is unprecedented in Australia. And the union's having a function on Tuesday in Melbourne to highlight that and push for better shield laws.
Is Adele Ferguson going to be there?
Adele's going to be there. It'll be Adele, Nick and Richard, myself, and I think Phil Doring, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, the short answer is the eight-word cliché, half a loaf is better than no bread. I mean, we're better off than we were before. We're not as well off as we could be. I've indicated to you the sort of things I'd be inclined to put in a shield law, which would be long and complicated, but we're halfway there, and that's better than having nothing.
Part of the debate, though, and it makes me uncomfortable talking about protecting journalists, putting journalists, we're just messengers, and the real thrust, the most important thing is to these whistleblowers, these sources are protected, and they're the ones that are often forgotten. And the biggest case to date is WikiLeaks, and everybody covers Julian Assange in glory. Whether that's right or wrong is a matter for others to judge. And people tend to forget poor old Bradley Manning. Mm. You know, if there's a hero in the WikiLeaks saga, it's the guy who took all the risk to expose these truths. Now he's sitting in a prison, and you know, there's far less attention given to him than it is to WikiLeaks and Assange. And I don't know how to get around that. Laws aren't going to protect people, sources, but we do need attitudes to change in government. They never will, but you know, the fight should be to make sure that people realise that, all right, there's been a leak, but at the end of the day, it's served the public interest. Let's move on with the business of the day, the important business of the day.
Well, look, I think that's a terrific place to finish. Thank you for all of your questions, and to those of you who sent questions on Twitter, I'm sorry we couldn't put all of them to the panel, but I'd like to thank first of all our panel, Nick McKenzie, Steve Pennells, Mark Polden and David Bennett. Give them a big hand, please. And I'd also like to thank all of you for coming, but before I let you go, I've got some more thank yous as well. In particular, Matt Davis and the team from Tilt Vision, who've been running the live webcast, Luke Bacon, who's been in charge of the social media, Lawrence Bull, who was the producer for this evening. We also need to thank James Hurley of UTS. UTS Audiovisual, and also Igor Konovalov from UTS Audiovisual Services. James Hurley, I should say, is from the Media Lab. And the FAS equipment staff, and of course our ACIJ volunteers and UTS students. Our camera operators, James McCallum, Jen Ng, and Harim Han, and the front of house, Samuel Caldwell, Rachel Worsley, Juliana Yu, and Tu Lee. And of course, most importantly, our ACIJ manager, Jan McClellan. So thank you all very much for coming along. And if you're not already a member of the ACIJ, or you'd like to be put on our mailing list for future ACIJ events, please leave your name and your email address outside. Thanks very much indeed, and good night.